things that I noticed when I went into the Muslim community and started talking to Muslim women who were high achievers, that they were equally or more proud of the fact that they were mothers. And this is a sharp contrast to a reunion I had with my school friend about 4 or 5 years ago. I don't know if you've got, well, you were, some of you beyond friends reunited. And we got together for the first time in 20 years, so it was quite a reunion. And I went over to two of my old classmates and asked them how they were doing. They'd been incredibly bright at school, and I imagined that, the world was their oyster. And I said, so what are you doing? And both of them involuntarily put their shoulders down, their heads down, I'm just a mother. Oh, I'm just a housewife, I've got two kids. Just, you know. When you talk to a Muslim woman and what are you doing, or she might be on a career break, or she might not have a career, but she's telling you with great pride, I have two children, three children, mashallah, and there is a great pride and dignity in the role of motherhood. It's not just a housewife and something to be sidelined. And without exception, every Muslim woman who's got a very well-developed career, a great career path going, never loses sight of the fact that if it happened already, one day she will be a mother, she will want to be a mother, and whether she has to combine career and motherhood, or whether she puts her career on hold to pursue motherhood, whatever happens, there is that goal there. And that is one of the distinctions, I think, with Muslim women and Western feminism. And I would humbly submit that the Western feminist movement, of which I was a very strong promoter in the 60s and 70s, actually inadvertently was so narrow in its focus that women of different cultures and religions were excluded because of this very sort of narrow driven focus of Western feminists. And unfortunately, when we broke through the glass ceiling, and I count myself in this, I was the first regional female newspaper editor, with Thompson Regional Newspapers, and the first female news editor in the region as well. We went charging off into the executive fast lane following the men. None of us said, hang on, we want to make our own path, we want to have our own career path to the top. And as a result, what has happened is you get really high-powered, high-flying female executives who are going all the way to the top, and then when they're hitting their 40s or 50s, they damn, I forgot to stop off on the way to have kids, because they went in one direction. Islam places so much importance and dignity on motherhood. As I say, that is one of the, for me anyway, one of the stark differences that I discovered when I went in. There are many different positive aspects to being a woman in Islam, but unfortunately, the media again pays very little attention to what we practicing Muslims have to say. What they will do is that they will pick out secular Muslim women Islam, but they're not representative of the Muslim community at all, and yet the media will talk to them as though they are experts. And they do it with men as well. Salman Rushdie, one of the biggest failed Muslims in the world today, he sits there pontificating about Islam and Muslims and gives a totally skewed and distorted view. And I would submit that him standing or sitting there on Newsnight or whichever program he's chosen to speak about Islam is like me sitting on the Faraday lecture talking about high-grade physics. You know, really, I'm certainly not qualified and I don't think that he is, but the media tends to set the agenda on this. One of the things that I'm really happy to see in this theatre tonight is the diverse and mixed audience that is here. And to the non-Muslims who've come, I would say, you know, thank you very much for coming to either show your support or take an interest or to find out a little bit more about Islam, and to and hopefully I would have listed some of the prejudices or low racism myths that there are out there. I know that there's a plan to have a question and answer session now. I think I should just start taking questions now. But I am not an Islamic scholar. I don't think we've got one in the hall tonight. We have. Please, if I'm unable to answer the question, don't take it as any other reason that I simply want to take a guess, which is something else that that I discovered when I started looking into Islam. The worst thing that you can do is try and guess the answer or try and give some information, although, you know, I might be very keen. If I give you the wrong information, that's the worst thing I could do for you to walk away tonight. So if I can't answer, it's because I'm not qualified to. I can give an opinion.